Cranston Mayor Alan Fung. Thank you for coming in today, sir.
Hi, Kate.
Step
How are you doing?
Right into the Go Local studio. What do you think?
Hi, everyone. This is very exciting. Very nice to be in downtown Providence. You know, I wish there was a little bit more activity, like what's going on in Garden City and Chapel View, you know, because it's really happening in Cranston. So you're all welcome to come and move Go Local to the city of Cranston, too.
Go Local Garden City?
Go Local Garden City.
Do I get a discount?
Absolutely. I'll get whatever you guys need. No tax breaks, but shopping discounts, I'll work it out for you and Molly and Tony and...
What about
you
know. Josh?
Okay, got to take care of Josh.
You got to take care of Josh.
But Josh, no tax breaks. Sorry about that, buddy.
No tax breaks. Well, we're not getting any tax breaks here, I'll tell you that, here at 90 West Boston Street. This is our third week, again, in the Navigant Credit Union Broadcast Center. It's been great, like having people in. It feels... you know, a really easy way to have a conversation about things. We have a very tiny camera that someday we will show you just how tiny the camera is. But coming in from Cranston, you started in on one of the subjects I wanted to talk about, development of Garden City. Very hot button issue, though. Some neighbors who definitely raised some issues. And I'm sure you expected that, just given the proximity to the residential area. But talk to us a little bit about the plans for growth, both at Chapel View and at Garden City.
Absolutely. And there's a lot of exciting things going on in Cranston overall. A lot of developments. We're growing. We almost caught Warwick as the second largest city. But I think that's a testament to all the work that we've been doing. And Garden City and Chapel View has really been that economic engine, that hub, that really has transformed not only just that central part of the city, but it's bleeding out into different parts of the city. And we're seeing a lot more, you know, businesses want to come in, not just the big guys, but small guys too. But in Garden City in particular, you know, as we saw in the paper today, you know, last night the city council had an opportunity to vote on a development plan district for Garden City to allow the developers, the management company, Wilder Companies, which are out of Boston, doing a phenomenal job from day one working with us, to have some ability to attract even more national companies, do what they need to do in the right way that fits and conforms to that area. And yes, it was controversial. You had a lot of neighbors. I think a lot of neighbors were concerned about the reach of that area, and the city council listened to their concerns. We listened to concerns, made a couple of amendments about height, how high it can go. Originally it was 100 feet. In one area they dropped it down to 75 feet. In another area they dropped it down to 35 feet and only keeping residences to try to address their concerns so it doesn't go out of control with height and impact their quality of life in the neighborhoods. But overall, it really has led to a revitalization in that area. Even St. Mark's School, that had sat empty, is now home to a lot of nice apartments, higher-end apartments, and it forced the owners of the old Garden City apartments to start renovating, too. And it all has led to a lot of higher property values. People want to go into that area, live there, because it really is providing a lot of convenience, a lot of great shopping, a lot of great restaurants, and more to come.
Now, is there room for, if you know, folks have been in Cranston, they kind of know the footprints of Garden City, they know the footprint of a Chapel View. Is there room for geographic expansion beyond the existing footprint that it's in?
Absolutely. I think what you're seeing is the geographic, maybe not those two areas growing a little bit more, but what we're seeing is economic revitalization all along Route 2. We're seeing a lot of old buildings that are getting knocked down and converted into modern retail. If you drive down Route 2 from Providence all the way, you know, to Garden City, you'll notice there's different buildings that are undergoing rehab, like the old Bickfords that sat vacant for years. And, you know, growing up, I was there for breakfasts, but now it really was dilapidated. We work with the developers, they knocked it down, and now it's the home of the Rhode Island Credit Union. Across the street where Domestic Bank used to be, there's a new developer going in there, giving that place a facelift. Drive down a little bit more, and you'll see an old insurance building at the corner that was knocked down and is the home of Wendy's with the drive-thru. So all of that is really leading to a resurgence in that area. And even as you move east a little bit more, that Ralph Square area, Dave's Marketplace is coming in the spring of 2017. More competition, I know, to a lot of the markets that are already there, but I love Dave's, love a lot of their prepared foods, a lot of excitement that's going on from a lot of our residents that are looking forward to them sitting on Pontiac Ave at that old Ciabra market and helping all along that corridor, Ross Street corridor, and you know, all throughout Cranston, Patuxent Village is booming, Western Side is booming. We're creating that dynamic where people want to come here not only just to live, but to work and play as well.
Now, why do you think, and we've talked about this here at Go Local, the success of Garden City and Chapel View, what do folks say when they say, we go there instead of Providence because...
I can name a couple of reasons, but one of the biggest things is parking's free.
Yes.
Parking's free, and the other is the safety aspect. You can go there, you can walk outdoors, enjoy the fresh air, particularly during the spring and summer times, have a nice, you know, ice cream at Newport Creamery, or yogurt if you're into the yogurt.
Get some Pinkberry.
Yeah, Pinkberry. or enjoy some of the nice restaurants, but shop and have some great shops from Pottery Barn, Container Store, LL Bean just came in, the Big Boot is there. So there's a lot that's going on, there's more that's going to keep going on, and that really has helped everyone enjoy the quality of life in Cranston. And what, for me as a city side, when you're doing that type of commercial development, this is why I'm so supportive of it, you are helping the residences, because the more that you increase the commercial tax base, the more it's keeping down the taxes. And that's how we've had 4 out of the last 5 years without tax increases in Cranston.
Give us a little preview, budget coming up. What can we expect coming out of Cranston?
Well, it's still in the early phases right now. In fact, my department heads are going through, meeting with their staff, prioritizing what their wants are versus what their true needs are. And that's what I'm going to push, is what their true priority needs are. You know, we've been doing that now for 8 budgets. I can't believe this is my 4th term that I started, 4th and last. But each time, we're always looking to make sure we make improvements, watching our dollars where we spend it, looking for efficiencies, working with other cities and towns to kind of save costs, and put together projects that help our residents. It's a little too early to tell what's going to happen yet, because I won't get my budget into the council until like April 1st. Mm-hmm. But right now we're meeting with the department heads, they're planning. But what I can tell you is we are going to make a renewed commitment to our infrastructure, and particularly our roads. You know, we've got school buildings that are in desperate need of repair. Public safety is a priority, obviously. But most importantly, we plan on doubling the amount of roads that we're doing and take advantage of our improved bond rating. Mm-hmm. I'm very proud of the fact that we're at the highest bond rating we've been in 25 years. And because of that, we've been able to refinance some old debt, saving hundreds of thousands of dollars for the taxpayers on, you know, different transactions, and all of it led to holding the line on taxes.
So what will be the biggest challenge in your estimation in the upcoming budget? Labor costs, other costs for the city, what are the greatest cost areas of concern to you?
Yeah, and the biggest thing always is labor costs, because you don't have a lot of flexibility in municipal, state, or even federal budgets, as we're about to learn as everyone's waiting for the president's address later tonight. Mm-hmm. But on the local side, about 85% of our municipal budget is tied into contractual costs. Mm-hmm. And the biggest chunk of our costs go to the schools, which we don't have any control over, but we do the best we can. We've got a great superintendent making sure we have good schools. I think today's paper, we all saw the graduation rates at many of the schools, and I'm proud to say Cranston has improved. They're in the 90s, high 90s for graduation rates, and we're going to continue to focus to make sure our students have the tools necessary to continue on to college or a career.
So talking about Cranston finances, you're here in the city of Providence, and I often ask politicians when they come in about the city of Providence and the current fiscal situation it finds itself in, especially with the pension obligation. Now, as you know, business leaders have broached the subject of bankruptcy, and Alan Hassenfeld, for instance, is one of the outspoken proponents of it. What would you say, looking at the state's capital, should bankruptcy be on the table as an option?
Well, I haven't been too familiar with Providence because I'm focusing on our own day-to-day
budgets. But if you were looking at more statewide issues, for instance.
You know, if you're looking at statewide issues, if you're looking at overall the health of the state, you know, as the capital city goes, the state goes as well. But one of the things as a municipal leader that you always have to keep in the back of your mind is the potential tool of bankruptcy. I know when I first got into office, I didn't rule it out. You have to consider all your options and potentially use it as a possible hammer in negotiations if you can't get where you need to be fiscally sound. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm not that familiar with Providence, where it's going, where it's at. That's a tool that the mayor's going to have to take a look at. But I can tell you, when I first got into Cranston and taking a look at the pension situation we had, the unfunded, we had one of the worst locally administered pension plans in the state from a funding perspective. And if we didn't fix that problem, fix all the problems that came out, fix our fiscal situation, the debt that the schools had initially when I took over, mm-hmm. we had to consider that. And I think as any municipal leader, even the mayor of Providence, you have to take a look and weigh your options.
Yeah, you can't just say it's not on the table. You have to. It's on the table with a number of other, as you said, options.
Options, absolutely.
So speaking of options, let's talk to statewide issues. Let's talk about the governor's budget proposal that she put forth. What did you like in it?
Well, I think one of the things that I saw was they, you know, stayed with their commitment to cities and towns and didn't take it on the back. Because when I first got into office, we took it on the chin. In mm-hmm. fact, Cranston lost in the first 3 years in office close to $20 million. That makes a big difference, especially the first, you know, days in office, and you get the news that mid-year you're going to be losing, you know, potentially $8 million. You're like, what? The governor didn't mention that when he was at my inauguration.
No, of course not.
Of course not. But the bottom line is this. We've weathered that. The fact that she did not take any more out on cities and towns is good news. But there's also a lot I don't like in her budget.
Well, that was going to be the next question. I was going to start soft and then go hard. And I do want to ask that the big brouhaha, as I keep going back to that, that emerged last week when Speaker Mattiello took to task her media approach for, specifically starting with the car tax, you know, her plan for partial elimination, taking the Speaker to task for his plan for complete elimination, and then doing so in the Cranston Herald. Have you seen a political battle between a Speaker and a governor like this before?
This is an interesting dynamic.
And you are in a very interesting place in this, aren't you?
Yes, I am. And I can tell you right up front and telling everyone, I'm going to protect the Cranston taxpayers and our revenue dollars, and that's why I support Speaker Mattiello's position to fully fund the exemption that $220 million, because that's the right way to do it so that cities and towns don't take it on the chin. Unfortunately, from what I'm hearing about the governor's proposal, it's creating a dynamic where you're basically putting cities and towns against each other. They'll be setting up winners and losers, and that's not right. Yeah. You know, it's supposed to be about local governance and local cities and towns managing, and this is not the same situation as the education fair funding formula. Let's face it, the state wants to start digging into cities and towns and what we set for tax rates, whether it's for cars, whether it's for property taxes, whether it's for sewers or anything else that we charge, then you do it and take away any type of local control. But when you start doing what the governor's proposing, trying to find some equalization, which is code word to me, meaning hurting cities and towns, hurting residents of Cranston to the tune of millions of dollars, I'm not going to let that happen. And that's why I support the Speaker's proposal, which would basically make sure that every city and town gets back every dollar and that the residents don't have to pay that car tax.
Okay, I'm going to bring you a little bit closer over here as you try to sneak out of the studio over
sorry.
Here.
Sorry, not trying to run anywhere.
Am I being that tough? Now the tough questions. Now. I know you've also spoken out about her proposal for a free college tuition.
Yep.
Again, not the price tag now I think is $8-9 million this year, but could expand up to $30 million a year. Yep. Talk to me about your thoughts on that.
You know, and that's why I came out against it right away, because as my parents taught me in life, nothing is free in life. There's always a hitch. And while I strongly support education and we've done whatever we can at the local level, I feel that before we start another program where we're likely to see another botched rollout like what we've seen from this administration, or another broken promise that we've heard from the governor and in our past track as treasurer, let's get what the programs that we have in place and do it right first. Let's use any additional dollars to fund education, making sure that our students have the appropriate tools as they get into college. Because I keep hearing more and more from employers and also colleges and professors saying, they're not ready. Mm-hmm. Remedial programs are needed. Well, let's put those dollars back into where it's really needed at the local level so that they can get the kids ready for a career or school, so that we don't have to worry about a feel-good program to push kids through and then potentially pay for it for all for political gamesmanship. And the bottom line for me is there are a lot of other areas that we can spend, whether it's education. Well, let's face it. The governor was out there talking about tolls. We need tolls because we have no new revenue. Well, when you have the revenue, you're not putting into the priority areas well like it should be.
Let's also talk about this administration. One of the things I've talked about with folks who've come in here, we had former Governor Chafee took affront to the Commerce Corporation's approach to economic development. He called it a candy store approach of economic development, bringing in big companies. Clearly, she's got her proponents on her side saying we need to bring these big companies in and that this is the only way to do so in competition against other states. Some folks go as far to call it corporate welfare. And I've spoken with you about this as well. What would you do in the situation of directing a Commerce who's got tools that were enabled, as we know, by the General Assembly to have this at their disposal? But is this the best approach for the state in terms of business development?
I can't believe I'm saying this, but I agree with Link on this about the candy store approach. It doesn't work. And when you have some of those dollars going back to companies that are already here and you're just shifting jobs from one area to another part of the state, you're not adding any new jobs. And that's the disappointment for me. You need to have Commerce to have those tools, but it should be angling to add new jobs, not to necessarily just move from one location to another. That's the problem that I have. Well, no, and I'll give her her due. There were a couple successes, but you have to figure out the dollars that you give from a tax perspective for how many new jobs. You have to really sit and wonder whether that's a proper investment. And that's where, you know, I differ from our current governor, because in Cranston, when you take a look at the developments in Garden City and Chapel View, I'm proud to say not a single tax dollar went into either one of those developments.
That's why you said when you're going to lure us down there that no tax breaks, but shopping breaks.
Yeah, that's right. Shopping breaks. I'll talk to the retailers themselves. I'll talk to them and see what we can do for you.
See what we can potentially do. Now, again, you ran in 14. What are your potential political plans?
Well, right now I'm focused on the city of Cranston. Standard response number 47. You'll hear more from me later, but what I will say is I thoroughly enjoyed the opportunity of being chief executive. I love that role, love the opportunity to kind of set an agenda. The challenges that it presents, I love the fact that when I got into Cranston, it was a fiscal mess. The city, Garden City in particular, Chapel View, was sitting there blighted, a little kind of run down, but having that opportunity, 8 years there, you can see what a difference and policy makes when you're willing to work with people to get things done, cut through the red tape, let businesses grow, let them thrive, and it's happening. You know, you have a lot of students that are there working part-time after school. You have a lot of people that are making careers out of some of these jobs. And you have a lot of good, wonderful local restaurants that are being part of the community, being supported by many of the residents. That's how you make it naturally happen, letting the private sector come in there, having the freedom to develop. And that's why I've talked even on different projects statewide, because I can see how what we've done in Cranston can be a recipe for the rest of the state. And just to bring it back to Providence, that 195 redevelopment project, everyone's like, what are you talking about when you oppose the commission? Yeah, I oppose it. It's another level of bureaucracy. Come on. You have to trust your local elected officials. Trust your state leaders to get it done right within the local confines. But when you create another level of bureaucracy and they don't have the resources to put things through, it's just going to frustrate developers. It's going to frustrate people that are looking at the land to say, how long is it going to take? That's why last night with Garden City, that vote was so important. It provides the developer management company flexibility.
Now, is that commission firmly entrenched? A new governor couldn't come in and basically dismantle the apparatus of 195.
Well, that's the thing. I don't think a new governor can, but, you know, any governor, hopefully. Any governor,
what would a new governor do?
Mayor new executive executive would, you know, take a lot of the blueprint that we've put in Cranston into place to say, look, we're going to work with you. We're going to cut through a lot of this crazy bureaucracy. If you can save some dollars by getting a shovel in the ground a month earlier, so it's less that you're going to have to pay out with no revenue stream coming in, then we're going to do it. If we can get your doors open, get the keys to the shop open, you know, a week earlier, a month earlier, or even a year earlier, we're going to work with you and do it. And that's, you know, the success we've had in Cranston. You know, there's been some ups and downs and challenges, but the bottom line is that's what you have to do to make sure that you have a business-friendly state, just like what we've created in Cranston.
And let's talk about something recently that came out of Cranston, the road safety ordinance that passed the city council that you were supportive of that has been implemented.
Absolutely.
How have you found that to be so far? And I'll have a few follow-up questions about
that. Sure. That was one of the things that I felt strongly about, and that's why I put it in front of the city council yet again after the last council had shot it down late last year. What frustrated me was the kind of, you know, the talk that was going about that it was only to target homeless. No, it really was about public safety, because I saw personally in December, and I took photos of this, an individual who was walking down the intersection of Park Ave and Reservoir Ave in the middle of the roads, almost get hit. And it wasn't a, you know, homeless individual. It was an individual that was part of the church group that was panhandling in the middle of the road as cars, as the light turned green, finally noticing it, dart in front of a vehicle. So, you know, that's why I put that forward. I'm glad the city council took safety as a priority. Right now, the police have implemented it. They've cited a couple of individuals, and it's working out, because all in all, it's designed to prevent any accidents for those individuals being in the middle of busy intersections and roadways. They still have an alternative place that they can do it safely from, but most importantly, it doesn't distract many of the drivers in our already busy roadways.
Now talk to us again. Is the first offense a citation? How does it work from a punitive standpoint?
It's not criminal, because that was one of the things that people were saying, you're criminalized. No, it's not criminal. It's a civil citation, just like a ticket, $85. But our police have been, you know, working with the solicitor's office about implementation, what they need to look for. But most importantly, our police have discretion too. We're not out there being heartless saying, oh, okay, we're going to cite you right away. You know, if they're not aware of it, you know, they have the discretion to give a warning to the individual. Look, there's an ordinance in place, you shouldn't be doing that. But then that's fair warning to provide to people. You know, we're going to try to work with all the individuals there with as much compassion as we can and make sure that we have safe roadways for everyone.
And you would obviously, I had covered it extensively, seen a lot of opposition from folks who wanted to see more social services and sort of safety net programs for folks in need. How is Cranston addressing that, whether it's drug rehabilitation or homeless individuals or job training programs? Very much that's what you saw at the city council meetings, of asking for that additional help for folks who might be on the side of the roadways doing that. How is Cranston addressing those issues that were brought to light?
Well, working with, first of all, our state reps and state senators, because a lot of this is a state issue. The subject of homelessness and the needs of many of those individuals and why they're homeless and the resources that are needed to be funneled are more at the state level. The city is going to do whatever we can to continue advocating for whatever resources, whether it's mental health resources, whether it's job, you know, tools that are needed to retrain. Because for me, if an individual is homeless and standing there, that's not a job. I'd rather have individuals getting the skills necessary so they can go out and work and do it in an effective way that they can sustain for a lifetime.
So do you think it took a lot of political capital on your part to push this forward? Do you see this happening in Providence or Newport, which it's on the table, but nothing's happened with it? Does the community have to be behind it to move it forward?
Well, I can tell you, it definitely takes a lot of courage, and I want to thank the members of the City Council for stepping up and recognizing public safety, taking, you know, my testimony seriously, taking the photos that I provided to them with that incident in December very seriously, because it was designed to prevent. We had also stories in Providence about there was a fight between two homeless individuals. I'm not sure if the individual, you know, died as a result of what happened. That's what we're trying to avoid. Even though it didn't happen in Cranston, when you hear the stories in close communities, you hope that others will be listening to try to find an effective way. And like I said before, when we passed it, we listened to the concerns of the ACLU. We listened to the concerns of those testifying. And it wasn't just the same ordinance that was introduced. The council narrowly tailored it, so it wasn't every single roadway in Cranston. They tailored it down so it's any roadway that's greater than 30 feet, any roadway that the speed limit is over 25 miles an hour. And that's what effective leadership is supposed to be about, listening to concerns, addressing it, making appropriate amendments, just like what happened with Garden City, to address some of the concerns of the residents. And that's the process that you have do as a leader.
Do you expect legal challenges? I know folks talked about it throughout the process, but you know, you made amendments. Do you expect a suit from the ACLU?
In 8 years, I've had this giant target on my back from the ACLU, so we're ready for one. We feel that the ordinance can withstand constitutional muster. We did our homework. We read the First Circuit case. We have very good, competent legal counsel that advises us at every step of the way. The same legal counsel that represented us at the first challenge the ACLU brought to the original ordinance, which even he agreed and we agreed was overly broad. So we did our due diligence, did our homework, but you know, in this society, anyone can sue everyone. We're ready to withstand it because it's the right thing for public safety.
Okay, well, let's broach even from city and statewide politics to national politics. Okay. We're expecting the address by President Trump this evening. How would you grade him and his administration so far and everything that he's done? And we'll go from the good to the bad, but give him a letter grade.
Yeah, I would say it's too early to give a letter grade. But what I can say, the positives that I've seen from his administration are, I like his focus on business. The fact that even before he took the presidency, he was meeting with some of these leaders and putting serious restrictions on them, saying, and whether you want to call it a threat or not, if you move these companies and move these jobs overseas, you're going to face some heavy penalties from this administration. And it caused some of these companies to have pause and keep some of the jobs here. And that's what we really need, is more dynamic leadership like that, calling it like it is and telling the CEOs, look, you'll have a partner in the administration, but don't mess with us because we will lay the hammer down if that's what's necessary. But on the corollary, we've also seen some, you know, I don't want to say botch rollout, but quick, you know, too quick of a rollout with the immigration executive order. I think you heard my criticisms of it, where when you're sweeping in lawful resident non-U.S. citizens that are here as part of that order, you didn't think it through because immigration is a very complex issue. There's a lot of components to it. You can't rush it through. So I'm glad he's taking the time to hopefully thoughtfully think it out, working with the their legal counsel to ensure that any order that's rolled out will withstand a challenge.
And what do you have to say? There have been indications of what the budget might look like coming out from this administration. Looks like a great increase in military and defense spending. On the flip side, social service cuts clearly are on the table. How do you think this is potentially going to impact Rhode Island and Cranston?
Well, I can't tell right now as far as any local impacts. From the big picture standpoint, I personally like the fact that he's making a commitment to our military again, because I did not like our troop levels at those low points under President Obama. The bottom line is this, we are facing a lot of dangers all across the globe, a lot of dangers even on our home front, and that commitment to our military I think is equally important. And who knows what it could mean. Maybe it could lead to more defense spending and Newport in Middletown at some of those companies that support our defense industry. That would bring some good economic news to us if that's the case. What I also support is his commitment to infrastructure. And you know, I know the Secretary of Transportation, Elaine Chao, very well, and I'm gonna do my part to continue to advocate for any dollars to help in Cranston and any other mayors and town administrators. I'll help you guys out too, you know, because we are one Rhode Island. We'll do whatever we can to kind of bring some of those dollars back home and, you know, make it a better Rhode Island.
And speaking of national GOP politics, Speaker Ryan coming to Rhode Island, are you going to be seeing the Speaker when he's in the state?
I don't even know the details. I was kind of caught a little bit by surprise, too. I've never had the opportunity to meet with the Speaker. A lot of governors I know, but the Speaker, you know, I really haven't had a chance to. I don't know the details about it. When I heard last night, you know, coming across the news wires, getting a few phone calls, I had no knowledge about it. So we'll wait and see what's going to happen there.
Now, I think I've seen on Facebook and social media some plans for protests already for him to be in. What do you have to say to this protest culture of folks continually to turn out on the progressive side at the State House, at events with the delegation?
Yeah.
You know, are we going to continue to see this throughout this administration? And do you see them having an impact on the administration, or is this just going to be life as we know it moving forward?
It could be a little bit of life as we know for it, but the question is how sustainable is it going to be? Because I saw when I was down in Washington, D.C. for the inauguration, you know, some of the protesters and really taking it overboard where you're burning some guy's limo. That's his career. That's his life, bud. And that's just plain wrong when you're going down that route of criminality. There's ways to do it. peaceful protests, civil dialogue and discourse is what our country is founded about, and that's what I will always stand and support. You know what? You don't have to, get to that level of criminality and, the disrespect that I've seen, whether it's on social media or even in person. That is disheartening to me. We've seen even some of the level of discourse happen, whether it's on Garden City, whether it was about the panhandling, road safety ordinance that we had, and that's fine. But there should always be a level of respect for both sides of a position. You might not agree to it, but let's continue on with serious debate and dialogue and get things done, work towards compromise, and pass it, because in the end, it's about Cranston, it's about Rhode Island, it's about our country, and we're all one trying to accomplish the same goal, and that's just raising great families and providing a better future for the next generation.
And you just had a birthday, did you not?
Yes, I did.
Happy birthday.
Thank you very much.
And did you do it in conjunction with a fundraiser?
Yes, I did.
Yes,
I have an annual tradition that I do where it's a birthday fundraiser, have an opportunity to celebrate with a lot of my supporters, but most importantly, my family and friends. And I won't tell my age yet because as I'm, getting up there.
Can't we just look it up on Wikipedia?
Yeah, that's true.
You can look up the
I'll make you do your homework as the age.
So as you're watching on Go Local, figure out on Google how old the mayor is. A bigger fundraiser than usual?
No, it was a nice fundraiser. So it was, and a lot of friends, a lot of supporters came out, and I'm very honored to have them because I can't do what I do every single day in Cranston or for people of Rhode Island without having their support to help me get my message out about what we're doing in Cranston and how it can effectively translate to other communities in our state of Rhode Island. So we'll see.
Now, I'd put you on the spot before, again, for another look at higher office. When do you expect, time frame wise, though, that you'll make a decision?
Yeah, look, I'm just really enjoying the job as mayor of Cranston, that chief executive role. And I'll have more to say in the future. Who knows when, but the bottom line is this. I thoroughly enjoy the job of, building a better Cranston, building a better future for the next generation. Same skill sets that are necessary for governor. And we'll see what happens. So, sorry, standard response 48 now coming up.
A little tweak. Well, speaking of tweaking, I'm going to tweak you here. Did you know that we ask trivia questions?
I'm in trouble now.
We ask trivia questions. It's this game called Day Trip. Now, it's just Rhode Island trivia.
Okay.
And I always say, why didn't they call it Road Trip?
That's right. There could be a copyright on that already. Someone might have that.
Road Trip. But you know what?
As long as you're not tripping while you're playing Road Trip.
Exactly. Yeah. Stay safe, kids. Pick a card, any card, so that we'll know that I'm not putting you on the spot here, and then I'll ask you a question.
Okay. So I'm putting myself on the spot, ladies and gentlemen.
Putting himself on the spot. Going to hand it over to me here. Let's see if I can have a question for you. RISD graduate Barnaby Evans conceived the idea of lighting fires and cauldrons on the rivers that run through Providence, better known as...
Water fire!
How many water fires do you think you've been to in your...
Oh, God, way too many. Way too many.
It is a great event.
Great event. Many romantic dates with my beautiful wife, Barbara Ann. Something we thoroughly enjoy. And it's great for the economy, great for Providence, great for our state. And something that I know that, when my friend... Angel was mayor, he took over to overseas to Italy and really tried to bring and highlight all that Rhode Island has to have. I think that's what I saw today about Commerce Corporation spending another millions more on. Look, let's focus on what we do well, do right, and that's what we can sell across the country, across the globe, and really have people come to our state for a tourism hub or, more importantly, to work here.
So I'm going to put you on the spot for one last question talking about tourism. I was at that commerce meeting last night, I believe $4.23 million. Now, this is on top of that $5 million and the initial campaign that, as we know, had a botched rollout, retained one of the firms for business attraction, two Providence-based firms and a New York-based firm. And you said spending millions on this now. They are going to keep the logo, they said. They're not going to do a tagline. What would you have rather seen in the approach to tourism as you just sort of poo-pooed the throwing the millions at it?
First of all, I definitely would not have hired the same guys that rolled out that last botched rollout with Cooler and Warmer with Havas. That's not once, but twice, because this administration had First Southwest back in the rolls, the same individuals that were providing the financial advice on 38 Studios. Really, ladies and gentlemen? Really? You know, so I think that's one of the things that really bothered me. This administration, this governor, that's still making a commitment to, you know, her supporters to give out and dole out, let's call it what it is, you know, our taxpayer dollars, you know, to provide jobs for her inside people. I don't know what connections they might have to the administration, but if one failed rollout isn't enough and you're seeing these continued botched rollouts, take a look at even UHIP, Deloitte. Yeah, now she's talking about, oh, you know, I've talked to the president. Okay, meanwhile, you're going out to California, unbeknownst to many people, to speak at a conference sponsored by Deloitte. And by the way, you know, you don't think we're going to find out about the two fundraisers too? Governor, come on. And I think Rhode Islanders are smarter than that. Let's focus on our individuals here. There are many people that are hurting from that UHIP raw. Many people that are embarrassed about cooler and warmer. Many people that are hurting and really need more jobs here. Let's focus on our economy. And by the way, stop hiring people from out of state. Let's focus on Rhode Islanders.
Well, you've heard it here from Mayor Fung. Pass the quiz test. Hopefully you'll come back with some small news, big news, any news.
No problem. We'd
love to have you here at the studio of Downtown Providence. So thanks for coming into Providence
today.
Have a safe trip back to Cranston.
Thank you. Can you stamp my passport?
did you pack a bag?
That's right.
Or you can hang out in lovely Providence. We've got lots of nice restaurants here.
Yeah, but you know what? We've got Dell's in Cranston. You can't beat Dell's.
We're gonna go to war. We're going to have a Providence-Cranston war. Mayor Fung, thank you for coming in today.
We look forward to
talking with you soon. I will usher you off around the corner and welcome my last
guest.
Okay, thanks, Mayor. Okay, you heard a nice long interview with Mayor Alan Fung from Cranston about thoughts at the local level.